Thanks, Fermin. Well, I must admit when, thanks you for the invitation, but I must admit when I got the mail, I didn't read it quite well, and I was so happy to talk here about those 40 years of career and the projects we've done with our great team. I am so proud about this team. And then a few weeks ago, I saw, oh no, it's about me, about myself. And this is really a challenge to do this. But anyway, if I'm thinking about myself, how what I am as a person, the first words coming in my mind is it's about people and passion. I think to understand this better, I have to explain you some context. And the context, the person you are, is defined by the family you grow up. And I think it's not different in architectural design. You can rebel against the situation. You can be very quiet and obeisant, and you can be very respectful against your family, but you can also be a combination of all those things. It's the same in architecture. And it can be depending on the time in your life and also the place you are with your family, but it can be also depending on the period, the exterior events which can happen. And I've been grown up in a very, inspiring family. My father was my hero. He was a very clever person, always studying and always working. My mother, on the other hand, she was the creative one. And every morning she had another thing in her mind. So this was very inspiring for my older brother and my two little sisters to grow up. But I must say it was a very strictly education, and so strict that we, not pampering, but strictly and severe, and we had to work hard, and we were not allowed to complain. And when I decided to study architecture, for my father especially, it was the were no architects in our family, and it was a little bit disappointing for him, because it was not university, it was only the academy. My partner in life, we met when I was 17, and we married when I was 20. And as some could think my husband is an architect, that's a question that I always get, but he isn't. My husband grew up and worked all his life in the retail business. And just this balance between those two completely different professions was very interesting for the both of us, because we could give an exterior view on each other, and this was very instructive for us. In fact, I could say my husband inspired me a lot. He's my tree to, or my tree to lean on when I have something in mind or some problem, but also my three children. They inspired me a lot, and they give me a lot of energy still now. Of course, you have to give energy to your children, but I'm receiving a lot of energy from them. I had the chance, and I was very lucky to meet Leon Stannen, and it was because of coincidence, because his partner, Paul de Meyer, was the uncle of my husband. And so my husband lived in a house of Leon Stannen. And during my studies, I could always pass by in the office of Stannen de Meyer after school. And I can say, in fact, Stannen and de Meyer were a little bit my after-school teachers. the teachers who inspired me at the academy were in fact two opposite teachers. And on the one hand, you had Georges Bains, who was with his really very poetic and clear projects. It was very inspiring for me. And on the other hand, there was Bob van Riet. And he was there with his strong statements and his very critical view on everything we did at school. And he made me think about building intelligence rooms for the future. I think in life, but also in work, everything is about balance. And this balance is different for all of us, for all of you. But for me, this balance means to dare to jump and to dare. And it's also about to fall and to rise up again, but also about the balance you have in your work and in your private life. Although this is not always in every moment of your private life the same. There are some moments that you have to work more, but if you keep always that balance in mind that you will get this one day, it will work. And for my husband and my children, nature was always a very important place to be in balance. And there we did a lot of hiking, and we went in the mountains, in the desert, the Himalaya, and a lot of places. And when you come back from this type of traveling, then you have a new view on your work, and you can see it with a very fresh mind. I started my office in 78, not 79, mm-hmm. and right after graduation. And in fact, it was about daring and jumping. But as you can see on the image here on the right, it's my 10 years younger sister, and please write her name down in your little booklet there, because it's she is the businesswoman of the family, and you better go to Google Birgit Konings instead of me. You will see. And she jumped a lot. Then I think everything in when I was preparing this, I got aware that everything is about a big learning process, a learning process during your whole career. And I think I'm still learning now. You learn from the people you work with in the office, but also your clients, and also the government and stakeholders. But for my first thing to work was my very first project was a renovation of our first house. And I just graduated. We were expecting our first child at the same moment, and our little apartment was too small, so we took a decision to buy a very small little house. And we took a big loan to buy it, and a second big loan to buy my very first drawing table. So this was the first investment in my practice. Then we started, and I was convinced that I could make everything with my own hands, that we could do it with our hands, because during the studies I always had been triggered by the Department of Art, the visual art, but the painting and the sculptures, but also the product development. And I was very fascinated how they could make everything by themselves. So I thought it's really possible that we will do everything in this house by ourselves as well. And this was really a very great experience. You must know at the time I started, it was not the best period for architecture in Flanders. It was the period of Lindbebouwing, which is urban housing development, I think, and also a period of urbanization and building parcellations in the nature and so on. And there was no much interest for architecture from government, from developers. They build it only for profit. And people building their own house, they wanted a copy of a rural house, a sort of fermet, how it is called. So if you wanted to do something of quality, you had to really defend yourself and to work hard to persuade and to educate the clients, in fact. And so back to this house. This house was only 4 meters, 44 wide, a two-facade house, but very deep. And I made a project to open it up in the middle, which was very unique at that moment for this type of classic house in Flanders. And this made this unique. And it was, yes, let's say, an experiment, a very a crazy experiment to do it that way. And this learned me a lot for the future. This house is a place I like to work on housing. It's still my favorite today, because it's much more than a shelter. It's about the emotions in the house, the memories you get there, and I think it's a very important place to be. But there I learned that with this experiment I had to think more in the future, because there were also things to improve. So I decided for the future for myself that I would do it in a different way for the clients. The next project I would do, I would design more in detail. I would think more before doing it, and I would certainly not overspend the budget. And I got aware that it's very important for a client, as I did it myself, that it's very important that they give you the biggest spend they will ever give in their life when they build their house, and that you can't overspend this, that you really have to be very careful with this and try to work for the future, and to try to make houses that will stand for 400 years. So we did a lot of research. It's about the zooming in, the zooming out. I got aware of this, that it's more about those roots of your projects, that this part is the most important part in your design. And in 83, I had my first employee that I engaged, and this was a very big step, because I never decided to have a huge office. It just came like that, and this was a very big step. I got also aware of how important it is to the buildings that you build for the environment, how important you can have influence with those buildings. And at that moment, we won a lot of competitions, and one of those competitions, I really, when I was preparing this, I remembered is that we participated for the Provincial Institute for Environmental Education, and with our team and with our landscape architect, we went on this site and we walked around, and we made the less intrusive project as possible on this site, because it was for environmental education. It was really important. And then I was standing there at the jury, and at that moment, George Baines was in the jury 15 years later, and I really made a very poor presentation. I couldn't say a word. It was so stressy because he was in this jury. And at the end of the presentation, the whole jury came to look at our models, and we had a small talk and a little dialogue. And I went out of the room and I told you, we lost this. We do something else tomorrow. And the next day we won. And then I realized that in fact, presentation today, those presentations, it's about 3Ds and 3D models and images and all those things. And at that moment, I realized it's really the deep roots of your projects and the research and everything you had. The content of your project is the most important part, in fact, of the thing. And then, of course, we put our values together to see together about the context and about the importance of durability, about the importance of people and the know-how that you make your budget right, and so on. And then 10 years later, my husband and me, we fell on another place, and I think preparing this lecture, I got aware that we have always coup de foudre for a lot of things, and there we found a place full of serenity, which is close to Antwerp and really close to the urbanization on one hand, and on the other hand close to the nature. And the first thing we did was to plant trees with our children, and when I see this tree, it's in fact the image of our concepts and the way of working. You have those trees with those deep roots; they get the energy all around, and then you have the growing part. This energy is for the analyze and all the things that you are thinking about, and then you have the growing part and the part that your project is getting adult, and then you have the fruits and the leaves and all these beautiful things that are coming out. Of course, this house has been built for generations, and we have all the time different families coming in our house to live, and it's a coming in and a coming out, and we organize every year apple pickings, and I brought some juice for you to taste, and every time a new family member is born, we plant a tree and we celebrate again. And again, this passion for different things is always with a certain meaning, and it's the same for art. We never invest in art because there is an artist who is en vogue, or an artist who is a good investment. No, we only do it when we see something which gives us emotion, and here it's very clear. It's again the trees who are growing, our three children who are growing in a different way, and the leaves above, and we hope with deep roots, that's what we aimed for anyway. I think my life is full of this type of coup de foudre, because some years later we again had fell in love for a place where we couldn't resist, and this time it was in an old ruin, an old place that had been used for centuries for farming and for the harvest of the grains in Tuscany, in the beautiful landscapes of Tuscany. And there we went through again through a whole learning process. In fact, you see it here on that place there. This is a zoom out, and this is a place where different houses are together around the courtyard, and people came there together, and we wanted to bring this new life of people coming again together on this place. And what I learned there on this place is, of course, I learned first of all Italian, but the second thing I learned is to think about circularity and to think about how you can, with the materials you have on a place, the materials you find there, how you can make something new, how you can give new life, and the missing materials, how you can try to find them in the environment, in the locality, very close to there, and how you can reinterpret them. And then the third thing I learned there was the conversation with the local architects and the local government of Asciano. And in fact, I made this project with this architect. He inspired me a lot, and he learned me how to do this in his country, and how the difference are with where we come from. So I think at that moment there was a big change also in Belgium, in Flanders especially, and in Antwerp. We had in Flanders our first Bouwmeester, the Bob van Reet, where I was talking about, and in the meanwhile some other Bouwmeesters. And we had in Antwerp also in 2000 our first Bouwmeester, and we were thinking also for the first time about mobility in Antwerp, which now is very good going on. And this was a very interesting process that we went through in Flanders, because we had a higher level in quality. Everyone, architects and urbanists in that period, were much more thinking about the quality of architectural design instead of 40 years ago, where this was not an issue. Some years later, I had to travel a lot for the office, and for instance, for the Belgian Pavilion in Shanghai. And there I went through another learning process. And there in Shanghai, during those 2 years, I traveled about 11 or 12 times to Shanghai. And if you see this image on the left, with Shanghai below and the guy on top playing his guitar, when I was resting in the plane, I was listening to the playlist of my husband, and I was thinking, is it really worth doing this? Is it really a good thing to travel all along the world to do projects? Is this the right way for us, for architects? And I think it's about understanding the place, and that's why we traveled that much to this place, because we wanted to understand Shanghai, and we wanted to make a building which was reusable in China on another place, and we succeeded in that. So I was happy with the project, but I was really wondering if this was the best way for the future, and if it's not better to work locally or a little bit closer to home, unless you have very good partners abroad and that you can take your time to understand the place in a very good way, that you go there, or you go there very often, or you don't do it. And so, as a conclusion, I can say that as an architect, everything comes together, and it's an all-round profession where we all the things are coming together, those emotions, those way of making good details, the way that we work together with our partners, with all the team, the great team that I'm so proud of. And I think it's all about people and about passion, and it's not at all about me and about ego. And that's just what I wanted to tell you.